Okay, we are continuing here with part two of the lighting designer. Let me make sure that my slide is working well. Let's see, boom, boom, there we are. Okay, so we left off with the types of lights, the lighting controls, and the new technology. And I'm really kind of going through this to not bore you with the details, because this is not a lighting designer's class, but just to kind of inform you about some of the basics. So a lighting designer has three types of lights. They have what's called soft edge spotlights, sharp concentrated spotlights, and floodlights. And I'm going to show you examples of what these look like and what they do. But a soft edge spotlight is a light that throws a spot far away that kind of looks like an area, not so much a sharp circle like you may see in a big spotlight in your high school auditorium. A sharp concentrated spotlight is a light like that spotlight in your gym or your auditorium at school, where you can throw a spotlight on someone very clear far away. The floodlights are lights that are meant to wash or cover big areas of the stage. The lights that are in your house above you, the light fixtures in your classroom, those are all floodlights. They're meant to give coverage. And so that's kind of the idea behind that. So those are the three main categories. There's variations of all of these. Some overlap with each other, and there's different types and brands, but we will not get into that. But these are kind of the three big categories. The one in the middle, the sharp concentrated spots, those are the ones that are more usable, and they can be manipulated more into soft edge, and they can give some good floodlight cover. Lighting controls, let's go to that, are basically a console, or now they're a computer-looking board, a computer that has a buttons and knobs and sliders and a keyboard and things of that nature. So you can use this control to speak to the lights that you have. So if we look at a theater, you may have up to 150 to 200 theater lights that are hanging, and so this controller helps you talk to all of those. And we say the word talk and speak to the lights because that's really what the controller is doing. The controller switch in your house, your light switch, is speaking to the lights. The reason why that's kind of the language is because it does and can seem a little complex in that it is overlapped with the processing and how computers work. In fact, now lighting consoles are, you know, connected to Wi-Fi. They upgrade on their own. They update on their own, and they're highly complex. But the basic concepts is what we're talking about today. A lighting controller can also do something like putting a look on the stage. That means lighting up areas of the stage and then recording that look. We call that a cue. A cue is a recorded look of a scene of lights on stage and how it looks. So for example, Q1 is lights are blue, Q2 is at a spotlight, Q3 is blackout, Q4 is take the lights away, Q5 is bring red lights up. So every single change in the lights are a look, which is a cue when it's recorded. We hear cue a lot in design. We'll hear sound cue. Costumers have costume change cues, actors have line cues, so we hear the term cues a lot. So a cue is kind of a look or recorded signal of when a look changes for lighting design. Fades, we record how fast or how slow a light can fade, how quick the light can come in, what it can do is it can, again, like we said, taking light away or bringing light to us quick or slow can really change a moment for us. A blackout, of course, is when the light is instantly taken away from us. And that can create some pretty powerful moments on stage. You can have a moment where someone is looking down at someone who is sick in a bed, and then the lights can slowly fade away from that moment. Or they can be taken away really quickly. If that happens, those are two different moments that is elicited from the audience. And so lighting can really impact how we experience something on stage. New technology is a category that I put on here in the resources because now it is overwhelming. If you have seen the Super Bowl, it is lighting designers who handle those halftime shows. They usually have four or five lighting boards. That's a handful, four or five universes going on. They can control lighting boards, can control drones. They can control other media activity on stage, like projection, things like automation, machinery. All of this can run through lighting consoles and boards. It's actually pretty amazing what can happen. But in the terms of lighting, we have lights now that are more self-sufficient. The instrument itself can have lighting capabilities built into them through computer processing and chips and things like that. They can also have internal colors now. They can have internal designs. I'm going to show you examples of all these. And they can also move and be more accurate. So the process for a lighting designer is to read a script. Then they create something called a light plot. A light plot is kind of an aerial view of how the lights will look when they're going to be hung, kind of like a ground plan. And then they go in and they hang and put the lights there and point them, focus them where they need to go. Then they go in and color the lights with the gels so they can have the colors they need. And then they go in and they record the cues into the board. The board is so simple that once it's recorded, anybody could run it. There's a go button that says go. You push go and you go to Q1, go Q2, go Q3, go Q4. Uh-oh, messed up. Hit back. Go back to Q3. The process of getting it in there and recording it does require some skill and training, but the person running the board is so simplified now. Anyone, if they can follow a cue sheet or they can follow the directions of a stage manager, could handle a massive production and run a play from the lighting board. That is how simple that is. Here's an example of a lighting plot. Notice you can see the instruments. We're floating above the stage. You can see the instruments here. These are lighting instruments to show you how they're laid out. These pipes are above the stage. We're floating above the stage. You can see this is a chair, a table, a library table, a lectern, and then a carpet. And so all these lights are all above all of this pointing down. Electrics are the strips of pipe that have the dimmers or the plugs built into them. It's really interesting. Let me give you a more complex one here. This is also a lighting plot. You can see how the lighting shows us where they're going to look and where they're going to point to. And I'm not going to get too much into it, but these instructions that you see here tell each instrument where to point. It tells each instrument what color to put in there. And it tells which area on stage to point at. Then, of course, there are notes here. But this is also the process of what a lighting designer will do. And then this key shows us the different types of lights that are there. This is a lighting plot, an aerial view of that. So here's a fuzzy picture of a lighting console. Sorry about the mess. It's a little fuzzy, but you can see here we have sliders, we have faders, we have buttons. These buttons here, you can talk to the lights that are out here. We're looking out a window in the booth, but here you can see all the numbers and all the lights on there. Every light instrument is plugged into a channel. Every channel is given a number. Typically, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, all the way up to 300 or whatever. So if I type in on the keypad and I type in light number 25 at 5%, I'll see it up here on 25 at 5%, and that light, if it's plugged in here, will come on here wherever it's pointed, and I'll know it's at. So that's how this console talks to the instruments that way. But this is what a console or controller looks like. Here's some examples of the lights, and this is nothing more than to show you what they look like. This is another controller you may find. These things are just like snowflakes, but some of them are massive. All these sliders here are here to set up different looks. You can do it manually, or most of the time it's to create looks, park them, use them for smaller projects, or take them and save a particular look so you can come back to it and then record it later. We won't get into all of that in detail. But these are instruments, ellipsoidals, more sharper spotlights here. These have a little more of a area spot area look, kind of like these, and then more of our flood lights here with the park hands. Some of these you may have seen or recognized. These obviously are on a much higher scale. These are other wash lights, as we call them. These are called cyclorama lights or cell lights. They can cover large areas of space. They can make a wall look like a sky because the power of these instruments are so hot and strong now we use LEDs and they're not as strong, and eventually we won't have these strong hot incandescents. But these are about 1,000 watts each. When you compare that to the lamp in your living room, that's about 60 watts. Here's some of the fun things you might have seen in a rock concert. These are the automated fixtures. They can wake up and do everything but change the oil on your car. I'm kidding. These have special effects, and these do some pretty neat things that I think is impressive as far as how we can check out some really cool stuff on stage with strobing, with built-in designs. That live waterfall that looks like a real waterfall, it looks like a projection can come out of these things. And you've probably seen a DJ use something like this on a smaller scale, but in the theater, these guys are about $3,000 a piece and are much more complex than what we see a DJ that might use in a club or a restaurant or something like that. Here's an example of what lighting can do. There's several others. I encourage you to watch the video that I attached yesterday. Look at those videos and follow those. It's so important you see those. You can see the amazing things lighting can do. But gobos can change a whole set into an outside look. We're indoors right here, and using gobos and leaves and blue, it looks like a moonlit sky coming through a tree, and they're outside. The scene goes away, we're back to the brown interior of the house, poof, we're inside again. This really does help move plays along. If a set design doesn't want to go outside, it wants to stay in one location, lighting can take us there too. If you've ever been to a concert, you can see how we can illuminate beams and do fun stuff with lighting beams for kind of these electric moments. This helps us with focus when we just want to see kind of an area on stage. That's kind of what this does for us. And here's examples of gobos. Gobos are cutout designs that can do any design you can imagine, and you see them on TV news shows and things like that, kind of showing you what news station you're watching. Light does a lot of that design, and it really saves on someone having to do it with paint and stuff like that. This is an example of a gobo sheet, shows you the different types of designs that people can get, and shows you how we used to cut these out in college, but there's so many amazing things that you can do with these. So you watch those videos on the lighting design, and you'll really kind of, a lot of this will kind of come back to you, and then that'll stop us right there. So this is going to end part two. This will give us kind of a conglomeration of what lighting design is. Watch the videos, all of the videos that I've attached. Just you should be able to hit control, click on those, or you can take it, copy it, and paste it into YouTube, or paste it into the browser and go to it and check them out. I know we all have time now, but check them out. It's actually pretty cool. I think you'll be pretty impressed by what lighting can do, and you'll also be pretty impressed by how much you've already seen a lot of this in your life. We just haven't paid a whole lot of attention to it. That'll kind of get us in the box of lighting design. I will go ahead and start working on sound to present to you in the next couple of days, and that way in a couple of weeks, I think we said the 26th is going to be the due date for the first report. And remember, you'll pick two elements of design that we talked about and put them into a 3 to 5 page report, and that'll be that first report we talked about. Okay, read everything that I have been sending you, keep up with all of that, and follow this, get your notes in, and we're going to go from there. Okay, thanks guys so much. Hope you're all well and staying safe, and I will see you probably by tomorrow or the next day.